Morning, everyone. Morning and welcome to worship here this morning on this fourth Sunday of January, which offers us our much anticipated annual congregational meeting that will start at 11:45 today. So the choir will have some time to wander down the hall here if you need to head out here. I'm sure many more will come in for the meeting, I tell myself. Right, so you didn't have to say it. Where was I? Something about Jesus. Hey, again, welcome. Please sign in on the fellowship pad that's in the pew near you. Let us know that you're here. I want to remind everybody that the 2022 flower chart is out in the hallway here. If you'd like to purchase flowers for our worship, you can do that on that chart there. Back to the congregational meeting as the excitement builds. The packets are at the doors. If you did not grab one already, we'll again have some time in between worship and our meeting for you to take a look at that. So if it looks a little brighter in here today, we had some painting done in the sanctuary here over this past week, and but if you say, well, they missed a spot, well, they missed lots of spots. They'll be back next week to finish up several places here. So that project continues. This Wednesday, our deacons will meet for the first time this year. That'll be Wednesday at 7 o'clock, 7 p.m. in room 203, 205 upstairs. Reminder that our time and talent sheets are available at the doors. They're also on the homepage of our website if you'd like to fill that out there. I'll mention that in my message later today. There's information on the insert about Redstone Presbytery and contributing to their work, the work of the greater church through First Fruits. That envelope is in your packet for today, depending on how you look at your envelope packets. So the suggested contribution per member is $43 for the work of the greater church. Redstone Presbytery meets this coming Saturday, January 29th at 1 p.m. at First Church in Greensburg. So with that, Sherry has a few announcements for us here today as well.
Good morning.
Good morning.
So just two quick announcements. One is that we are desperately in need of nursery workers. We really just need someone to commit to once or twice a month for the Sunday school hour and the 10:30 hour. We have someone doing twice a month right now, so just need to fill out the rest of the month. If you can do that, please talk to me. And then we also need snacks for youth group. If you can donate some canned soda or bags of individually wrapped snacks, they would greatly appreciate that as well. Thanks.
Thanks, Sherry. This concludes our morning announcements for today, so let us prepare our hearts for the worship of the living God.
Good morning. Please join me in the call to worship found in the bulletin. The law of the Lord is perfect, refreshing the soul. The statutes of the Lord are trustworthy, making wise the simple. The precepts of the Lord are right, giving joy to the heart. The commands of the Lord are radiant, giving light to the eyes. The fear of the Lord is pure, enduring forever. The decrees of the Lord are firm, and all of them are righteous. Let us pray. God, our Father, it is our privilege and joy to praise you. As we sing, let us make a joyful noise to you. As we pray, may our words and thoughts be pleasing to you. As we open your word, may we trust in your unfailing promises. Your word holds true. It is living and active among us every day. Open the eyes of our hearts that we may see you more clearly. Help us, Lord, so that we may do your work to help those in need whenever we can. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, amen. The first hymn for this morning is number 557, Christ is Made the Sure Foundation. Let's affirm our faith by reciting the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he arose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Let us pray the prayer of confession found in your bulletin. God of freedom, Jesus came to bring good news, to mend and to heal, to release and to redeem, and to proclaim your reign. We confess that we have ignored his message. We remain captive to sin, bruised and broken by our transgressions. We are convinced that the news is always bad and that we are forever stuck where we are, as we are. Help us to hear the truth of the gospel. Inspire us with your liberating word. Let your spirit cleanse us and change us so that we may receive all that you have declared in Christ Jesus our Lord. We ask this. Amen. Hear the good news. The saying is sure and worthy of full acceptance that Jesus Christ came into the world to save sinners. He himself bore our sins in his body on the cross, that we might be dead to sin and alive to all that is good. I declare to you this day, in the name of Jesus Christ, your sins are forgiven. Amen.
Thank you, choir. As we enter into our prayer time here for this morning, we want to continue to pray for Lynn Gilligan and Bob Stevens as they recover at home. Also, prayers today for the family of Nick Pushnak. We prayed for him the last few weeks. That's the father of Carrie Barnes. He died this past Wednesday, so prayers for that family. Prayers for our deacons as they meet for the first time this year, this coming week. Pray for prayers for their work and continued prayers for our world as well. Let's come before the Lord in prayer together. We thank you, O God of Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, for this time together here in worship and this time in prayer. And we pray that at this time that you remove from us the busyness of our lives, our worries, our concerns, that we may focus on you, on your goodness and your love. As we pray together today, O God, we thank you for the work that you set before us, before this congregation. And we lift up to you our insert sheet. We pray for our meetings to come here. We pray for our deacons, especially as they meet this week, and just pray that you would continue to give them hearts of compassion and caring and service to this congregation and to this community. We pray, O God, that you would continue to guide all of us to do the work of your kingdom as we approach our annual meeting here today. We look back on a year of ministry past and a year of ministry to come, and we thank you that you remain with us through all times and all circumstances, and that you remain the same, that your love for us that has come in Jesus Christ never changes. We lift up to you today those in need of healing, and we continue to pray for Lynn Gilligan, that she may know your presence and your love. Pray for Bob Stevens as he recovers from a seizure, and ask that you would give him strength and healing, O God. We thank you for your comfort and peace and the hope that we have in the resurrection of Jesus Christ, and that you walk with us through the valley of the shadow of death. We pray for those who grieve among us. We pray especially today for the family of Nick Pushnak, and ask that your comfort be with his family at this time. Lord, we pray for our world as we continue to live in a season of pandemic. We pray that you be with those who are suffering from COVID-19, for those who are treating those who are ill. We pray that you give all of us patience, help us to trust in you, and that you will guide us through this time here, O God. We continue to pray for our world, and where there is chaos that is man-made or brought about by natural disaster, we pray that the hope of Jesus would be known in those places and to those people. Help us to be instruments of your peace, O God. So we pray together, we ask that you would quiet our hearts as we come before you in a few moments of silent prayer. Hear our prayers, O God. We lift up to you the names and circumstances that are listed in our bulletin here today. May we be mindful and prayerful of them. Help us to come to your throne of grace for all things. Help us to be people of prayer. We trust, O God, that you do the work of salvation, that you do that completely in Jesus Christ. We pray that you would continue to strengthen us as we do the work of your kingdom. Continue to move us and grow us in the power of your Holy Spirit. Thank you for this time together in worship and time in prayer. And we ask all things in the everlasting name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
His name is wonderful. His name is wonderful. Jesus, my Lord. He is the mighty King, Master of everything. His name is wonderful. Jesus, my Lord.
As we continue in our worship together today, we, with joyful and thankful hearts, we come before the Lord now with our tithes and our offerings.
Let us pray. Faithful Father, thank you that you give the gift of abundant, eternal life. Everything we have is a gift from you. As we bring forth our offerings, we give back to you from the abundant blessings you have given us. May our gifts be acceptable in your sight, O Lord. May you bless the ministries these offerings support in our church and our community. Amen. Our praise song this morning is The Heart of Worship.
Stripped away, and I simply come.
You may be seated. The Old Testament lesson is from the book of Nehemiah, chapter 8, verses 9 through 12. It's found in your pew Bible on page 418. Then Nehemiah the governor, Ezra the priest and teacher of the law, and the Levites who were instructing the people said to them all, "This day is holy to the Lord your God. Do not mourn or weep." For all the people had been weeping as they listened to the words of the law. Nehemiah said, "Go and enjoy choice food and sweet drinks and send some to those who have nothing prepared. This day is holy to our Lord. Do not grieve, for the joy of the Lord is your strength." The Levites calmed all the people, saying, "Be still, for this is a holy day. Do not grieve." People went away to eat and drink, to send portions of food and to celebrate with great joy, because they now understood the words that had been made known to them. May God bless this reading.
New Testament lesson for today comes from the book of Acts, chapter 2, verses 42 through 47. It's found on page 937 in your pew Bible. I invite you to turn there. We're going to look at that passage today. We read of the church in its very infancy here, after the day of Pentecost and the Holy Spirit descending upon those who trust in the Lord Jesus. Here from Acts chapter 2, verses 42 through 47. "They devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and to fellowship, to the breaking of bread, and to prayer. Everyone was filled with awe at the many wonders and signs performed by the apostles. All the believers were together and had everything in common. They sold property and possessions to give to anyone who had need. Every day they continued to meet together in the temple courts. They broke bread in their homes and ate together with glad and sincere hearts, praising God and enjoying the favor of all the people. And the Lord added to their number daily those who were being saved. We give thanks to God for his word to us today. Please join me in prayer. As we worship together, O God, we come now into your word of scripture that directs us to your word of life, your word made flesh in Jesus Christ. We thank you for our salvation that is completed by Christ in his death and resurrection. We thank you that we belong to the church of Jesus Christ that is solely his. We pray that your spirit would speak to us and guide us now. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. So today is our annual congregational meeting. So this is part sermon, part state of the congregation address, if you will, leading up to our greatly anticipated annual congregational meeting. Of course, our Book of Order, part of our Constitution, says that we are to do this every year. We reflect on a year of ministry past and a year of ministry that is before us. Now, these past 2 years have been a great challenge for us here at Level Green. They've been a challenge for probably most every congregation around the world here as we have lived in this season of pandemic here. The year 2020 was filled with things that we could not do, canceled events. This past year of 2021, we found ourselves trying to figure out how we could return to some of those activities, things that we couldn't do the year before. So as we move now into this new year, into 2022, we open up even more here. We continue to live as the Church of Jesus Christ together here in fellowship and in an exhibition of faith to our community around us. So we see the church in its very first days here at the end of Acts chapter 2, and there's a few thoughts for us, three thoughts for us today on what the church does in those early days and what we as the church some 2,000 years later are to continue to do. So as we look at Acts chapter 2, verses 42 through 47 here this morning, we are called to spiritual devotion, we are called to sacrificial giving, and we're called to transformation. So first, we're called to spiritual devotion as we look at verse 42 here. The church is devoted to four things as our passage begins here. And the word devotion tells us that there's a single-mindedness among the believers. They are focused primarily on these four things. The first is what is called the apostles' teaching, that they are above all committed to grow in their faith. They want to learn more about Jesus, who has provided them their salvation, from the men who eyewitnessed his earthly ministry. They want to learn how to live according to Christ's countercultural kingdom. They want to hear more about the power of God in the miraculous works of Jesus during his ministry. They want to continue to grow closer to the Lord Jesus himself. Today, our first devotion, the apostles' teaching, as it's called here, is put together in the scripture of the New Testament. We have that written for us. And our first devotion is to continue to grow closer to God through the study of scripture, just as the early church does. The word is central to our worship together, what we do on the Lord's Day here. And so that is central to what we do, and all of Scripture directs us to Jesus, to God's plan of salvation that is revealed as God comes to us in the Son, Jesus Christ. So that's our first devotion. The second is we see the early church committed to fellowship. Now, this doesn't mean there's enough green bean casserole to go around for everybody at the potluck, we're talking about much more than cookies and coffee after the sermon for the day, the teaching of the day, that fellowship, as it's intended in the life of the church, is people walking together with the Lord, sharing in our joys and our struggles that come about through life and life with Christ. So true fellowship is much more than just a passing, kind of fleeting time together. It's a lifestyle that we live together as the church. The third is the breaking of bread. Now, this could refer to common meals that the early believers shared together. They were called, it's called the agape feast, the love feast, which would have in part been communion as well. But this more likely refers specifically to what we know as the Lord's Supper and the sacrament of communion. Communion reminds us of the sacrificial death of Jesus on the cross, believing that he died in our place, in the place of our sin, unites us together in faith. And as we consume the elements of communion, which we do about once a month here, that it reminds us of the desire that, Jesus has to live in relationship with us, that we are to consume Jesus, and he is to be the focal point of our lives. The fourth item listed is prayer. If we're going to grow, and we see this in the early church and true for us today, if we're going to grow, we need to pray. And if you desire to grow closer to God, then you need to pray. When we pray, we submit our will to the will of God. And so we are to be continually people of prayer through all times and circumstances, to pray without ceasing, as Scripture says. So as the church executes these four things here, these four devotions that they live out, they continue to live in community. It reminds us to seek community as well. That the Lord has always called his people to live in community. He gathers his people to himself. We see this in our Old Testament lesson from Nehemiah chapter 8. Now, Nehemiah is appointed as the governor of Jerusalem by the Persian emperor Artaxerxes, who's holding the Jewish people in exile. Nehemiah is allowed to return to Jerusalem to rebuild the walls of the holy city. Ezra, who's the priest at the time, is charged with rebuilding the temple in Jerusalem. So we see these two men together, along with the Levites, the priests, teaching the people, reintroducing the law, the first, what we know is the first five books of the Old Testament, to the people of Israel here once again. The response of the people as they hear of their disobedience to the Lord, their sinfulness, that they're overwhelmed and they begin to lament. But Israel is told here not to weep on this day, that God desires to bring joy to their lives. As they're made aware of their sin, they're also made aware that God provides and desires to forgive them completely, and that ultimately comes in Jesus Christ. So as community together, we're reminded of our sin, we're reminded of our salvation, the cure for our sin that has come in Jesus Christ. And as we live in community, we continue to seek a simple living, seeking simplicity. Everything that we do as a congregation must come from our devotion to the Lord. If you look at these four items here in Acts chapter 2, verse 42, what the church is devoted to and committed to here in its first days, there's nothing gimmicky here, right? There's no coffee bar. There's no laser show. There's nothing like that. There's no quick fixes here, nothing flashy, very simple, things that are to be done daily as the church. So it tells us that we're to remain focused on spiritual things. So often we get hung up on something attractional, what we can do as the church to bring more people in. But as we continue to live in faith, that God will continue to honor that, that the Lord is the one who grows his church. We see exponential growth here in the life of the early church, the Holy Spirit moving powerfully. But as the Spirit continues to move today and we continue to live in faithfulness, that this growth will be slow, it will be steady, but we're called to continue to walk in faith. At our most recent session meeting just a few weeks ago here, our elders spent about a half an hour discussing where we are as a congregation, taking some time to vision here into the new year, and we're planning to continue to do that. So there were three questions, very simple questions that came up during that time. To community together as Jesus Christ, that the Lord will honor that and will continue to grow us here. So it's very simple things that the Lord calls us to do here as we live in faith together. Second here, we're called to sacrificial giving. And as we look at verses 43 through 45 here, we see that those within the church trust in Jesus, and those outside of this new faith community are in awe of the signs and the wonders that are evidence of the living God at work in the life of the apostles. The church is only located in Jerusalem here at this time, and its foundation, so all of the believers are physically, geographically together. And we're told that they share all things in common. They share a common faith together. That some of these new believers have left behind everything to follow Jesus, just as the apostles did as they left behind their lives to walk with the Lord. So the believers are willing to sacrifice for one another to the extent that they're willing to sell property and possessions to provide for others in need. So we hear this, and we hear this. They share all things in common. It sounds like grounds for communism. But what communism says is what you have is mine. What Christianity says, and as disciples of Jesus, it's the opposite. What I have is yours. We're called to freely share with one another, be ready to share with one another, to meet the needs within our congregation first, to meet the needs within our community around us second here as we live sacrificially in honor of the Lord and out of thankfulness for our salvation. So as we continue to live sacrificial lives here, we continue to support one another. Again, the church is just located here in Jerusalem. There are Jews who have come into the holy city here for pilgrimage, for the Pentecost festival, and they've heard of Jesus maybe for the first time ever, and they come to faith in him. So some of these new believers need others to provide for them during this time. They can't go home. Their lives have been radically transformed here by believing in the good news of Jesus. So as we continue to live today, we continue to provide for one another. We support one another in physical need and in spiritual need as well as the church together. As we do this, God calls us to stay uncomfortable. To be welcoming, we always say what? We say, make yourself comfortable, right? We cherish our comfort and our possessions, and our society places a great value on our comfort and our possessions. But as the church, we should have the opposite approach. When we're uncomfortable, we trust in the Lord. We continue to rely on God in those times that we're uncomfortable, and we no longer rely on our own strength or power that's within us. We continue to rely fully on the Lord. As I mentioned earlier, we have our time and talent sheets available at the doors here today. I invite all of you to take one. You don't have to fill it out, but when you do so, you can leave it in the offering plate or in the office. You know, prayerfully consider new ways that the Lord is stretching you to do the work of his kingdom here, something you've never done, maybe something that you're going to be a little uncomfortable doing, but consider those things as we do the work of the Lord here at Level Green Church. Finally here, we're to be transformed, that our lives are transformed by the good news of Jesus Christ. And we see that here in the early church especially, that every day these new believers meet together. Their lives have a brand new focus to them. They continue to meet in the temple courts. They meet in their homes also. As they meet in the courts, this area is probably Solomon's colonnade. The temple was great in Jerusalem. The disciples meet in the temple after Jesus ascends into heaven. We read that at the end of Luke's gospel, and Luke is the author of Acts here. So the church, as it starts, continues to meet in the temple courts. They realize that what they're doing is holy work here, so they continue to meet at the temple. They continue to offer praise to God out of their thankfulness for their salvation. They all live in a proper relationship with God, living in awe of God's goodness. The church is attractive to everyone here. Those within the church live in harmony together. Those outside of the church, the new way here, as it's known, is appealing to those outside of the faith at this time. So with this, more people are coming to saving faith in Jesus Christ every day, and the Lord grows the church in number daily. It's the Lord that grows the church. The church experiences rapid growth here in its formative days and months, that the Spirit's moving powerfully here, but it starts as the Church of Jesus Christ. It remains the Church of Jesus Christ, and He is the one who grows His church. Jesus knows who will trust in Him for their salvation, who will turn to Him to repent of their sins and desire to live and to walk with the Lord Jesus every day. So as we live as disciples of Jesus, we trust that Jesus is fully in control of His church, that the church belongs completely to Him. It's not my church. It's not your church. The church belongs now and forever to Jesus. And Jesus is the one who does the spiritual work in the hearts of those who believe, and He grows us in faith and grows us in number. So as we continue to live and follow Jesus and work together as the church, we are to be joyful. So many today have no idea why we're here right now, what we're doing. You know, this is a place where you're told what not to do and how bad you are and all the rules that you have to follow. But we're in the business of grace. We've received God's grace, that God gives us what we don't deserve in salvation through Jesus Christ. And as we live as the church, we've done well, as the church has moved away from the center of our culture here, we've done well to add to the confusion that people have about what we do as church and what it means to be church, what it means to follow Jesus. If you've asked anyone who's ever worked in a restaurant, when they've served their most demanding customers and their poorest tippers, they'll tell you it's about noon on Sunday, folks that are coming from church. If you ask any grocery store employee or anyone else that's worked in retail, their most difficult customers have just come from worship. I've heard that several times from folks. Of course, the opposite should be true, that God calls us now to live joyfully, knowing that the trials of this life are fleeting compared to eternity in the presence of our faithful Savior, Jesus Christ. We are to go and to tell others and live in a way that shows that God is at work within us, that we are now free to live and to live joyfully through faith in Christ. It's time for us here at Level Green, for the church around the world, to return to the basics of the church. So often we get caught up in our building. Of course, I have to say that the week we paint in the sanctuary, that we get caught up in our income and our membership numbers and even in our programs, that we measure the physical things as the church and we neglect the spiritual. We're called to lives of spiritual devotion, to the study of Scripture, to fellowship, to living together, to the sacraments, to the breaking of bread, celebrating the Lord's Supper together, remembering what Jesus has done for us, and continuing to be people of prayer. We continue to live in community together. We're to seek out community. I know it's been a challenge here through COVID, and many are live streaming, hopefully, here this morning, and so taking part in our worship that way, but there's nothing compared to being present and in fellowship together. We need that to continue to grow and to sharpen one another as disciples of Jesus. As we live for Jesus, we continue to live simply, trusting that the Lord is at work in our lives and at work in the life of His church, and we continue to trust in Him that He continues to do the work of growing us in faith and growing us in number. We're called to sacrificial living as we see the Lord Jesus offering His life for the forgiveness of our sin, that we live sacrificial lives as well. We continue to provide for our needs within this congregation, the need within the community. This makes us uncomfortable, but as we lack comfort, we trust more in Jesus. Our lives are transformed by what our God has done for us in Jesus Christ, and we trust that God is at work in our lives and continues to be at work in His church, growing us in faith and growing us in number. And as we live for Jesus, as our lives are transformed, we're now joyful people, thankful for our salvation that has come once and for all time in Jesus Christ. May God continue to guide us as we do the work of His kingdom here on earth. Let's pray together. We thank You, Father, for our salvation that has come in Jesus Christ, for the gift of Your Holy Spirit that speaks faith to us, for your Spirit that equips us and strengthens us to do the work of your kingdom here on earth. Lord, we pray that you would continue to guide us here in this new year. Guide us into the business that's before us here today. We continue to pray for those who lead us here in this place, our elders, for our deacons. We pray that you would continue to guide them here and strengthen them. Lord, may we grow closer to you here. May your Spirit draw us close. We ask all these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Our closing hymn for us this morning here is The Church's One Foundation. Please stand. Now receive this benediction. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God the Father, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you this day and forevermore. Amen.